Once it works, nobody calls it AI anymore. I love that quote because it exemplifies just how many companies are going to start touting themselves as AI being a critical driver of their business, when in fact they're just dipping their toes in the water. And AI can also be as much a threat as it is an opportunity, especially for companies like Adobe. And perhaps the first thing that comes to mind when you think of Adobe and AI would be all the images they produce and whether or not they're going to be cannibalized by AI algorithms that can produce millions of images at the drop of a hat. So I was looking for imagery for this particular presentation. I came across this nice paint splash, and you can see here it's by Clemenso. And when you search Adobe's site for imagery from Clemenso, it's all from Gen AI, and you see here how they're baiting you in. So the standard license is free with a trial, of course, and then there's an extended license there, and you can download this if you sign up for a trial. And when you look around at the AI imagery on offer from Adobe, you'll come across photos like this. Here's a smiling construction worker in a bright safety vest standing on a construction site. Simple, upbeat, and professional indeed. And this is spectacular performance from their AI algos to produce an image that looks like this. But then when you keep on going down and you see this image here of Cleopatra and you look at her claws, you see that AI still hasn't managed to get hands right. So while there's still work to be done, Adobe is certainly using AI to produce lots of images, and the Motley Fool here goes so far as to call them an AI stock. I highlighted this this horrible behavior from the foolish pundits looking at the performance of a stock when less than 3 months has gone by. What is interesting is this key point here. They say Adobe's guidance suggests that AI isn't giving its business a big enough lift just yet. Well, maybe it isn't an AI stock then. So when we look at the impact of AI on any company, ground truth is always revenue growth. And I think there's three categories companies are going to fall into. There's the few where you're going to see a strong revenue growth jump. NVIDIA epitomized that. Arista Networks may be another example of strong growth on the back of data center buildouts. Then you have some companies that have strong growth offset by weaker segments. So you can think of a Micron or a Marvell. And then you have most companies where AI is simply a tool to sustain continuing growth. And when we look at Adobe's growth, these are quite compelling charts. On the left, you see their quarterly revenue growth, and it seems to be stalling a bit there or plateauing. And likewise on the right, when you look at their annual revenue growth. So is AI simply a tool that can help them sustain continuing growth as opposed to really add some real value? And then when you think about Adobe in particular, did their failed acquisition of Figma cramp their growth plan? Sort of a what now? We're going to talk a little bit about that. But when you look at Adobe's acquisitions over the years, here you can see that Figma was the largest one by far. It wasn't approved. So now they're left going back to the drawing board. And it seems when you look at their latest investor collateral, for example, the 2023 letter to shareholders, it's unbelievable how many times they use AI in that letter. It's just really cramming it down investors' throats. So things we want to discuss today. What does Adobe do, first of all? Is it really a SaaS company? And is AI an opportunity or a threat? Now, when we think about companies we're going to invest in, our tech investing strategy is quite subjective, so we have to know about what companies do, whilst our dividend growth strategy is purely objective based on Q scores, and it doesn't even matter what a company does, though we do care at an industry level. So when you're trying to understand what any company does, a basic understanding can be found in the 10Q filing, and then you supplement that with investor presentations, which will oftentimes provide additional metrics. And what we found is the larger a software company becomes, the more difficult they become to describe because they start broadening their they're offering, right? And Microsoft is probably an exception. We did a piece on them, and it's remarkable how well you can break down such a big company because they provide you with the information that you need where you don't have to really go digging for things. Now, before I get into talking about what Adobe does, I just wanted to ask you to support our work. In the comments section, we're going to have a link to our newsletter. Please sign up for that. This individual remarked recently that we're a little bit of sanity in a sea of bullshit, and I think that's absolutely right. So nothing but quality content. Another person recently said that they subscribe because our interests align with our customers, and that's absolutely right. If we help you become a better investor, you're going to open your wallet down the road, and that's what we do. So let's talk about what Adobe does. Now, this is one of the first slides in their year-end deck or their Q4 2023 deck. And you see they have $19.4 billion in revenue. So keep that in mind because we're going to keep referring to that as we dig into their segmentation. Across the top here, you're given a hint. So they talk about unleashing creativity. Well, that's the Adobe Photoshop. We probably all know what Photoshop is. It's become kind of an adjective, right? Oh, I'm going to Photoshop something, right? In the same way that you're going to Xerox something. So this is a very strong brand, leading brand. Then you have PDFs. Everybody probably knows what a PDF is. It's a document format that's become quite popular. So it's another section of their business. And then you have this comment they make about powering digital businesses. Now, this is the cookie problem and customized marketing. We're going to touch on that. It's rather interesting. So when we look at their, remember, $19.4 billion in revenues, we see 54% coming from the United States. That's nicely diversified. You kind of want to see revenue breakdowns that mimic like MSCI, ACWI, all the countries in the world. So this is not bad. When we dig down a little bit deeper to look at segmentation, again, the red arrow there points to the $19.4 billion, and then look to the left. You have publishing and advertising, digital experience, and digital media. So I've marked these 1, 2, 3. 1, digital experience. 2, creative cloud. 3, document cloud. So those are the three segments that we're interested in. And they make it rather difficult to try to suss this stuff out. But takeaway here, too, really. First of all, look at gross profit for digital media segments. So that's creative cloud and document cloud, right? The Photoshop and the PDFs. 95%. That's almost reaching arm levels. That's insane. So that's really their cash cow then that drives this other segment, digital experience, which I think is 5 years old. And we'll talk about what that is. The other thing to note here that's important is that they talk about how digital media subscription revenue is 97% of total revenue, but then they also make reference to annualized run rate. So that's a SaaS metric. These things start to become confusing in a hurry. So your ARR can actually be more than revenues, potentially less than revenues, because revenues are simply when you recognized the money, and ARR represents the run rate you'd have if nothing else changed. So they sort of use subscription and ARR interchangeably, and it can get confusing. But at any rate, let's talk about the Creative Cloud. And you see here where that arrow points to Firefly. So that's how we came across the Creative Cloud. It's not the first time that we have. So we were subscribed to Adobe. We used to use InDesign to produce our reports. It turned out to be a pain. And certainly, you don't want to pay for something that's complicated to use. You needed a trained individual to use it. Not anybody can just open up InDesign and start doing cool stuff. So we canceled that subscription. But we were also looking at, you know, Adobe Stock Photo compared to Big Stock Photo, which we're using less and less of since now we can generate imagery using AI. And that's where our thoughts were around how Gen AI impacts Adobe. So Creative Cloud is really people being creative. So any sort of company that produces collateral marketing materials, they're going to use Adobe's cloud, and you can customize subscriptions. Adobe is very clever. So if you go to cancel, they say, well, what if we offered you 30% off to continue sort of thing? Or what about this? They were even criticized once for, I guess it was not letting people cancel, or it's making it very difficult to cancel, we'll say that. So that's Creative Cloud. And their use of Gen AI to push more people, you can see here, 90 100% of Firefly. So that's their AI creative app. And it does things like text effects. You see here, generative fill. So that's intuitive, right? You simply point to this woman's jacket and it automatically figures out you want to change your jacket color. Text to image, that's what we use, right? So we want an image of something. We put in the text and it generates an image. So people come to use this to see all the cool stuff that they can do. And 90% of them are not current Adobe subscribers. So those are leads. You see increase in traffic to Adobe 25%. So they use that quite well. A clever method of marketing to boost subscriptions to Creative Cloud. I don't know how many more they can sell. But then when we look at Document Cloud, so look at the use of AI in this diagram here. It's just their deck is peppered with AI. So you have AI-assisted conversational experiences, AI-powered editing and formatting, AI-supported review process. And is a review process really need AI? Isn't that something that you could just do yourself with traditional software, perhaps? I don't know. But the point here is that are these solutions a nice-to-have? Is this a solution looking for a problem, or are people actually going to find value in this stuff? So those are the two segments of digital media. And when we look at their fiscal year 2023 results here, we can see that the digital media component, as I said, they mentioned $1.91 billion of net new ARR. Well, how does that compare to subscriptions? I don't know. But we can calculate ARR for that segment. And the question that I would have there immediately is, how much of this is being charged against credit cards versus enterprise contracts? That's very important. And the SaaS revenue buckets you see firms provide oftentimes, like we have X number of customers paying us more than 10K or paying us more than 100K or a million. Those are usually the buckets. That would be very useful here, and we don't have that. Now, the next number three, or in that previous slide, this was number one, digital experience. Let's talk about that. So I liked this chart here. It showed how customer expectations, and I don't know anybody expects that valued personalized experiences from brands. I certainly don't want brands to be personalizing anything. I just want to go and buy what I need. But people seem to find that brands ought to personalize experiences. They say less than 50% of marketing content is currently being personalized. So don't think of that as using your name in a subject line. Think of that more along the lines of taking all the activity that you do in a day on your browser and then using that to figure out that, oh, you're going on a holiday to Thailand or you're looking to purchase a new gas stove, right? So when we think about personalization, then they typically do that with cookies and this 3P, that's third-party cookie deprecation. And if you're in our business, you realize just how much absolute shit there is with regulations around cookies and permissions, and you'll see it, especially in the EU. And this is posing a problem for people who want to understand who the customer is. So what they're simply doing here is creating a platform that helps you effectively market to large populations of customers and segment to them. So it's you can see here the Adobe Experience Cloud and customer journeys. You know, that actually makes a lot of sense. We do some of that here in terms of your funnel and personalizing the way that you turn leads into subscriptions. So this whole domain is referred to as a digital experience platform in particular. And here you can see Gartner's quadrant from 2019 to 2024. And look how Adobe has jumped up and to the right. So they're a clear leader in this space. And when we think about the size of this opportunity, and actually the opportunity for everything that Adobe does, you know, they say here their path to 30 billion. So remember the 19.4 number, they're figuring out how do we get to 30 billion, right? And their Document Cloud TAM, $32 billion. I don't know about that. Certainly if they double document revenues by taking everything away from DocuSign, which we actually did a recent piece on DocuSign you ought to check out, and it appears that Adobe's might be eating their lunch. If you notice on Adobe's slide talking about the value add they bring to documents, that digital signatures wasn't a unique selling proposition. That's because it's just a small thing, and DocuSign fell behind. Instead of selling other things, in AI in particular, they're playing catch up while Adobe's actively capturing value with AI. So then you have the Creative Cloud TAM again, $63 billion maybe. I mean, you need to look at if somebody's using creative software right now, or they're in the business of being a creative, then they've probably purchasing what they need. So that's, there doesn't seem to be a lot of blue ocean in either the document side or creative side. In other words, they need to steal market share from competitors. And is there really close to $100 billion in TAM there? I don't know. But what's more compelling here would be the experience cloud TAM, which they describe as $110 billion in itself. And that would be where every marketing team would need a platform like what Adobe's building. So pay attention to subscriptions there. Now, when we think about them being a SaaS firm, you see here the 50 biggest SaaS companies. I took the top 10. This is from Mike Saunders. And you can call Microsoft a SaaS company, I suppose. But they're more looking for pure play SaaS. And all these companies, I think, are starting to spin. We recently covered ServiceNow. Here's an article on our site on that company if you're interested. It's quite good. They're, of course, pivoting heavily into AI. If everybody's using AI, then nobody's an AI company. So Adobe's the 42nd largest company in the world. And when we think about what's a SaaS company, at least from our perspective, how about one that provides basic SaaS metrics like annual recurring revenue? So Adobe's use of ARR and subscription revenues is puzzling and confusing, and they ought to sort that out. Net retention rates, I mean, they make a comment in one of their presentations on how net retention rate is strong. Well, that doesn't tell me anything. We need numbers, right? Or revenue buckets, as I described earlier. And then gross retention rates, those aren't typically given, but that would be very useful to know. Again, we want to understand just how much of this business comes from people that sign up with a credit card versus enterprise contracts, the idea being there how sustainable that will be over time. So just some concluding thoughts. Digital media is clearly the cash cow for Adobe with 95% gross profits, but how many more subscriptions can they milk out there? AI is an obvious opportunity for value-add features, and we looked at some of those. It's currently driving lots of leads for their creative cloud. Now, AI's impact on each of Adobe's segments, so the experience platform, that's the future direction of marketing, and Adobe commands a leadership position, as we saw per Gartner. So there doesn't seem to be threats there. Document Cloud, that has many added features. Solutions looking for problems, perhaps? I don't know. We'll see if people are willing to pay more for that stuff. And then Creative Cloud. So this is the questionable one. Do all designers out there have a subscription to Adobe products? Probably. Do we need all these designers still? Are there going to be a lot of unemployed designers? One could argue yes. So Adobe's strategy should be something like this. Create immense value add and increase your average revenue per user to counteract those lost seats. Again, we're not given much granularity on what's going on when it comes to seats and such, so we just have to look at revenue growth. Right now, it seems to be tailing off. So going back to that point made in that Motley Fool article, this AI stock isn't showing a lot of results so far. We'd really like to see some SaaS revenue buckets from Adobe so we can understand the business better. For example, how many subscription seats belong to fly-by-night content creators that won't be around once they realize that creating content is really damn difficult. So I'm going to go ahead and leave you with a video that we did on Microsoft. It's actually quite good. Be sure to give that a look. Make sure to please, in the comment section, subscribe to our newsletter and support our work. Make sure you're subscribed to our channel. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this today.